Right. So we're studying through the book of Joshua, and we've been going chapter by chapter. When I left off with you guys a couple weeks ago, we were studying chapter 7, and it was a good time there. So logically, the next spot would be chapter 8 in the book of Joshua. So what I do is, and I always do the same thing. I've shared this with you before. I do the same thing. You know, I just start praying. I'm like, all right, God, what do you, like when before I even do a series, I'm like, okay, God, what book do we need to go to and lead me there? Because I need to learn something, and then they need to learn something, and so, you know, we come together there. And so I ask for that guidance, and then week to week, I ask the same guidance, really. It's just not a whole book. It's just, you know, like, I'm reading this text. Okay, so what is it? Like, what do we got to do? So my next step would be, I've done 7, so I went back, and I prayed, and I go back into the Bible, and I go to Joshua 7 again, and I'm reading to kind of get myself right contextually, you know, for chapter 8. And so I read in chapter 7, and then I read on to chapter 8. And then I read chapter 8 again, and I read chapter 8 again, I've read it like 10 times. I read this chapter over and over again, and you know that the Bible talks about itself. It says that it's alive. Okay, well, it wasn't, right? did you ever get that way? Just you're reading it, you're like, yeah, I might as well read Cat in the Hat, because there's just nothing coming out of this for me. I know it's good, but I'm not getting anything. So I don't know what to do. And so in the past, I've been doing this now for several years. In the past, I have been prone, and I know that I'm not alone, to kind of force the issue with God. Anyone? Anyone force the issue with God? Like you want something, and you will it to be done, and then you slap the Holy Spirit on it and go, it was God. You know what I'm saying? It's not the way it's supposed to be. So I've come to realize in recent history that when I'm doing that, and nothing's jumping off the page, it's not that the Holy Spirit is sleeping, okay? It's not that. It's not that the Bible is not valid. It's just that maybe it's just not where God wants me to be. Maybe he just wants to take a little detour, right? And so maybe there's something in me, so as I pray, like, God, what do I need to learn? What do they need to learn? Well, maybe it's not in Joshua chapter 8 right now. He's God. He's sovereign. He knows what's going on. He knows what's going on inside your hearts. For sure, and so he gives you something to talk about. He gives you something new. So I just put Joshua 8 aside. I was like, all right, Lord, what? So that's when the journey begins, right? You start digging. You crack open that old book, and you start reading and reading and reading, and all of a sudden, just wham, there it is, right? So I got there. And so what I did is I started reading in Matthew, and I can't explain exactly why I was reading in Matthew. I heard some messages over the last couple weeks from the book of Matthew from different pastors and preachers, and so maybe that was just to prep me. I don't know, but whatever. I'm in Matthew, and I get to Matthew chapter 9. And I get to Matthew chapter 9, and Matthew chapter 9 is a very familiar text for us because we're the church that put up the billboard that says Scumbags Welcome, right? So we know the story. I shared it with you a couple weeks ago. Once again, about how Jesus meets Matthew and he invites him to be his disciple, and then Matthew invites his buddies, all of his other disreputable, scum, awful people that nobody likes in town, and he invites them to dinner. And so the religious folks come, and all the rotten, no good scoundrels come, and they're having dinner, and all of a sudden the religious folks look over and they're like, you know, Jesus, what's with all this scum here? What are you doing with all these, you know? And so he jumps up and he says, you know, healthy people don't need a doctor. Sick people do. And then the next line in that Mark story, Mark chapter 2, is that I didn't come to save those who think that they are righteous, but those who know that they're sinners. So we're familiar with that story, right? Well, that story takes place in Matthew 2, but there's a sentence in it that's not in Mark. And I want to invite you to go there. It's in Matthew chapter 9. And I want to read this one sentence with you. Now, as I read this, I want to tell you that, like I share with some of the worship team here when we're praying earlier, that this message, even though in my absolute heart of hearts, and I know it's in the heart of God, is evangelism, to go spread the kingdom of God. You know what I'm saying? Like more people, lead them to Christ. Like I'm all about that, right? I got a fire underneath me all the time that I can't seem to put out. And I want to go and tell everybody about Jesus. And I know that's in his heart. You know that because in Matthew 28, in his great commission, he's like, now go tell people about me. Make some disciples. Go dunk them and teach them all that I've taught you. And so I take that really, really seriously. and that I want to teach you all that he would teach me. And that lines up with the prayer that I have every week. Lord, teach me something that I could teach them. And I take that really seriously. Well, at the heart of the Great Commission is this whole idea that I cannot teach you anything until I've been taught. And so I take that very, very seriously. So when I got to Matthew chapter 9, and I'm reading this story that was so familiar to me, I'll start again. I'll read it to you. And you're going to hear the same words I just shared. Why does your teacher eat with such scum? Verse 11, here's 12. When Jesus heard this, he said, healthy people don't need a doctor. Sick people do. And here's our text. Then he added, Jesus added, quotes, now go and learn the meaning of this scripture. I want to show mercy, not offer sacrifices. You hear the brakes? Do you feel the brakes? Okay, so here's the thing. If the word became flesh, and this is in red, and this is Jesus Christ talking, it's not something to be blown by. Like, we have a reading plan, and every day I got to read a chapter. Right, so I got to do this. It's routine. It's regiment. I got to do this to be a good Christian. Right, but this is the word of God, and the Son of God just said, now go and learn the meaning of this scripture. So should I just jump right through it and keep reading, get my chapter done? See, when you read the Bible, you have to know that is God talking to you right there. That's an amen spot.
Amen.
You guys got to wake up. That's Jesus Christ the Lord speaking to you right then and there. And it's not to be ignored. It's not to be ignored. And I take the commission seriously. I got to teach all that he's taught me. And so when he told Moses, stop what you're doing and go learn the meaning of this verse, I had to do that. Now I'm going to share some things with you tonight, and it's going to fall on different ears and different hearts. Some of you are going to hear what I have to say, and you're going to say, well, this really affirms what I'm doing and where I am with the Lord right now. It's going to make you feel good. It will. It will make you feel good. And I hope that's most of you. Some of you will hear what I'm about to say, and you're going to get maybe a little bit angry. And you're going to say, no, I'm good. I don't know what he's talking about, you know. That's who this is for. And some people will hear these words tonight, and they'll say, you know what? Yeah, this is me, and I feel very convicted in a good way, like I want to do better. So I hope that's you as well. So he says, now go and learn the meaning of this scripture. And so that's what I did. I spent my week doing that. The Bible tells us something weird. Well, he says a lot of things that are weird. One of the things that it says in the Bible is that if you confess with your mouth and all that you're saved. Okay, so now I'm 100% saved. I confess, I believe, I'm saved. I'm saved. Got glory promised. But it also says to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Now, they seem to have an apparent contradiction. But what I'd like to offer you is that that salvation is also is future hope, but it's present as well. It's present reality. And so when you work out your own salvation, it's what you're doing right here, right now, as a saved man or a woman. Okay, it's not what's going to happen in glory. In glory, it's already been told to us in Scripture what we're going to be doing. Do you know what that is? We're going to be hanging out in the presence of God, telling him how awesome he is. That's all you're going to do. It's going to be awesome. Glory, glory, glory. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. We're going to be praising him 24/7, 365, forever. That's what we're going to do. But right now it's a little bit different. We have to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. So there should be some importance there, that fear and trembling thing. What I would like to talk to you tonight is the difference between salvation position and salvation practice. Okay, salvation position and salvation practice. Keep that in mind. What Jesus is talking about here in Matthew chapter 9, he summarizes a quote from Hosea chapter 6. Hosea chapter 6, verse 6 says very similar verbiage, but it's expanded a little bit into two sentences, and it just says this, I want you to show love, not offer sacrifices. Now, the Greek in the Hosea says show mercy as well, but the Hebrew says love. So what God is telling us here is that these two things are sort of interchangeable, okay? Showing mercy is to show love. He wants you to show love, i.e. mercy, but not offer sacrifices. I want you to know me, God. God says, I want you to know me more than you bring burnt offerings. Now, what is the, just to kind of tell you what I'm talking about, like sacrifices, burnt offerings. If you read in the Bible, there's tons of times when those things were being done, sacrifices and burnt offerings and all this kind of stuff to the Lord. But could I just summarize it this way? Because there's tons of reasons. But quite often, the system that we had set up, God had set up with his people, is that there was like, I did something wrong. Let's just call it what it was. I messed up, and so I bring a sacrifice. You know, you slice an animal open or whatever, and you throw the blood all over the altar and stuff. There was a sacrifice. It was like, I'm sorry, and this is what I got to do to appease the wrath of God. I got to bring these to the temple. I got to bring these to God. Offerings and sacrifice, that's what I did. And so what God is saying here is that I don't necessarily just want those things, because from the heart, from inside of you, comes the motive for the outside action. So what I'm saying here is what I believe God is saying is that you could bring a sacrifice. Let's just say that this was still the old temple or even the tabernacle with the altar and stuff. You could bring an animal to say you're sorry, and you could slice his throat and throw blood all over the place, but if it doesn't represent what happened inside of you, it's worthless. Okay? I could bring a cattle up here and set that thing on fire and burn it up to the Lord, but if it doesn't represent something that God did inside of me, then it's worthless. And so what he's saying here is that these religious activities that kind of look Christian, sound Christian, taste a little bit Christian, that doesn't necessarily mean that they are. That doesn't mean they necessarily are. We could take communion. Right? In this church, we take communion all the time. You know, it's just a cup and a cracker, right? It's not really Jesus' body. Just kind of want to let you in on that little secret. We buy them at Walmart. You see, so the wafer and the juice, I could, like, you don't sit in the front row, okay? You could take the cup and you could take the cup. And really, that's all they're doing is drinking a little grape juice and eating an oyster cracker. But if there's nothing going on, like if there's repentance here and confession of faith and there's a turning of sin and embracing Christ and you know, true, genuine repentance and conviction inside this heart, and he's doing it, it means something. But if there's nothing here, going through the motions because everyone's doing it, my mom told me I have to, you know, it's nothing. It's just a cracker. It's just juice. And so religious activities, even though that they look Christian and all that kind of stuff, doesn't mean anything. I could get up here and I could baptize someone right now. There's water in that tank right now. You can come up. We will dunk you right now. Like, I'll do it if you want. But if it doesn't represent the turning of a heart from sin to Jesus, it's worthless. It's worthless. Baptism's worthless. You can sit here and pray holy King James prayers that make everyone impressed. But if it doesn't represent what's genuinely going on in your heart, worthless. All those types of things don't really matter. Stuff's been going on for a long time. In both the Old Testament, I mean thousands of years, Old Testament, Isaiah, New Testament, Matthew, God says that there's been people that honor him with their lips, but their hearts, see, they're doing the stuff, but their hearts are far away. So I don't know who you are here in this room tonight, but you're either someone who's genuinely doing things because of the outpouring of your heart, like it's going on in here, or you're just going through the motions. I don't know. You know, it got so bad, this religious activity, and by people that there was a time, I don't know, I don't have to give you a big old history lesson here, but there's a guy, his name is Martin Luther, and he was a German monk, and he didn't like the way some things were going on in the church at the time, and so he came up with this piece of paper, and he tacked it to the door of the church, and all. I don't want to bore you about that, but he was objecting to this thing that the church was doing. They were selling indulgences. The indulgence was like the epitome of what Jesus is talking about doing religious stuff, but it doesn't really represent anything. You could buy forgiveness. You could buy, not only could you buy forgiveness for you, you could buy it for a dead dude. You could buy forgiveness for a, now let me just tell you something. It never worked, but people thought that it did. It looked religious. It was part of the church activity, right? But if you don't confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you ain't going. And so you can buy all this, these indulgences you want. That was the depravity of the human heart, that we thought we could do this religious stuff that would somehow get us into God's good graces, and it didn't work. We have to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. You see, the things that we do, that's not the goal here. The cross was never aimed at your hands. It's never been aimed at your hands. It's always been aimed where? At your heart. It's always been aimed at your heart. See, the outward expression of a person, it's rooted in the inward knowing God. When it's said here in Hosea, I want you to know me, this is where the outward expression of one's life is rooted in this knowing God thing. Okay, it's like if there's a tree, at the end of the tree branches or the end of a vine, there's some fruit. Whatever's exposed out here that you see that this tree produces, it's all a direct result of the roots that are underground that you cannot see. Whatever's being sucked up into the tree or into the vine is what will come out here. Okay, this is not the goal. This is not the main thing. What's the main thing? The main thing is found in Colossians 2:7. Let your roots grow down into him. Let your life be built upon him so that your faith will become strong in the truth you were taught. That's what you have to do. We have to take our lives and grow, put our roots down into Jesus so that he can go up into us and teach us some things about himself. And then what will happen is this inside of us, it's marinating in our heart and it's wandering around in our minds. And what happens when this is all going on is the fruit at the end of our vine becomes sweet and beautiful. It's the roots that go down. See, you have to know God. See, if you don't know God, you can, like I said, you can bring sacrifices to the altar and you can do burnt offerings and you can get baptized, you can take communion, you do all these church things and give like crazy. They mean nothing. They mean nothing if the roots aren't down in Jesus. If you don't know God, all this stuff is worthless. But if you know God, this stuff happens. It's just a natural fleshing out of having a relationship with God. Knowing God, it says that you will grow, your faith will grow strong in the truth that you were taught. Knowing God, here's the truth of knowing God. If you know God, then what happens is you start wrapping your brain around this immensity of your sin. And then covering this big pile of sin that you have, covering it with the love and the kindness of God that sees your pile and just says, I love you anyway. I will forgive you. I want to help you. I died for you. See, knowing God means that you realize that you have a loving Father that will absolutely provide for your every need if you will seek first his kingdom. And having a father that absolutely discipline you because he loves you so much, he would rather crack you in the rear end for a little sting than watch your life fall off of a cliff into total disaster. That's what God will do. That's what knowing God means. Knowing God means that you know that you have a Father in heaven who will connect you with other people that you can love and that you can serve, and then likewise, they can love you back. Knowing God means that if you're his kid, you're a new creature, a new creation. You're the king's kid, and in that lies entirety of your identity. That your identity is no longer wrapped up in all of your former life, your former sin, your former failure, your former mess-ups and your hurts and your pains and the wounds of the past. That is not who you are anymore. Thank you. Thank you. Knowing God means that he delights in you. Knowing God means that you realize that God is patient, that he's very, very patient with the one who rebels against him. Knowing God also means that you realize that not only is he patient, but he's also extremely willing to forgive and embrace that rebel the moment that rebel turns back to him. Knowing God means understanding that he saved me by his grace, not by my tremendous works. So I can't brag on me, but I could and I should brag on him. Because I don't want to get all holy in with you, but why do we brag on him? He's so nice. He's so super nice. He's kind. He's generous. None of us were looking for it. None of us deserve him. No one deserves salvation. No one is looking for salvation. No one has earned salvation, but he gives you salvation. That's my king. That's it. That's the kind of God he is. Knowing God means that we realize that if we add up all of our sin, that the true sum of all of our sin, every sinful action, every sinful word, every sinful attitude, every rotten perspective that's not of God deserves nothing good, no good reward, but oh, his grace. Oh, his grace. See, if you get to know that God, that's my God. And that God, if you get to know him personally, that relationship will never push you into religious practice. That will never push you into just solely religious practice, routine, tradition. This is what we do. This is what we do. We come in, we do this, we do this, we do this. 10 Hail Marys, 14 Our Fathers, communion, pray, sing, go home, dress this way. This is the way we do it. Regiment, 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 regiment. Can you imagine? I mean, you guys, well, I grew up in temple, so I can imagine it. You go into this expression of who God is, and it's just this boring, lame, unengaged, you have no idea, up, down, soldier, soldier. Like, what is that? Is that God? Look at the foliage on a mountain in fall in Vermont and tell me that the best representation that we can come up with is, whoa, 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 regiment, everyone dress the same, do the same, sound the same, come on. That is not God. That is not God. He won't just push us to sacrifice and burnt offerings. He won't push us to, oh, I'm so sorry all the time. I'm so sorry all the time. I'm so sorry. Justifying, making excuses for yourself. That's not what he wants. See, when you know God, he drives you to something totally different. However, I want to just say this, that he does want you to be able to say you're sorry. He does want to create a safe environment like a good father here on earth would create where you can screw up and you can come say, I'm sorry. That he's not some lightning bolt throwing, you know, I'm afraid to screw up because daddy's going to whip my hide so bad because he's pissed off. Sorry, write me an email. He's pissed off at me so bad that he's going to kill me or something. Like, that's not, you want to be able to, you know, I mean, I have a dad. He did suck. I couldn't go up to him and tell him anything, right? So I want to be a dad that my kids can come up and if they screw up like super bad, they should still be, I might whoop them, but they're still going to know that I love them. Like, you create a safe environment. So the Bible tells us in 1 John 1:9 that if you confess your sin to him, he doesn't condemn and throw you into hell. If you confess your sin to him, he is faithful and just to forgive you of your sin and to cleanse you of all unrighteousness. So when he says, I cleanse you of all unrighteousness, it means all the guilt and shame that goes along with your failure that you would normally receive and put on yourself, that self-condemnation, I suck, I'm terrible, I'm no good. No, you're the king's kid. You're fine. You're fine. You just messed up. We all do. But continuing to say you're sorry all the time, that's not the full extent of Christ's redeeming work on the cross and in your life. If you have a kid, I get a lot. I want my child to be able to say, I'm sorry, I messed up, right? Dad, I didn't clean my room like you asked me to. I'm sorry. Okay. Are you guys cool with that? If your kid comes up and tells you that? Cool, right? Hold on a second. Okay, now, how about the very next day? You know, Dad, I'm just terribly sorry. I love you, and I forgot. Would you forgive me? I'm sorry. I mean, that's cool, right? Okay, how about the third day? So the third day he comes up, and you ask him to clean his room, and he just says, you know, Dad, I love you, and I just, is your blood pressure coming up already with mine? I'm not even talking about my kid, but I'm already getting mad. I mean, you guys, you feel it, right? Rusty's face is turning red. So do you understand what I'm saying? Like, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, it's fine. Okay, how about this? quit doing it. At some point, this whole reality that if you're in Christ, you're a new creation has to kick in. You know what I mean? It's got to kick in. It has to kick in. Here lies the intersection of salvation position and salvation practice, okay? What I mean is, by God's grace, like he saved me, right? So by God's grace, nothing I did, nothing I earned, nothing I even was even looking for, by his grace, he does something nice for me. He sends it, in Colossians 1:22, it says that he sends his son, the son dies in his physical body, and because of that death on that cross, not of mine, but of Jesus, because of that, that God has brought you into his very presence, holy, blameless, and without fault. You didn't even do anything. You just said, thank you. You didn't go on that cross. I didn't go on that cross. Jesus went on that cross, and because he did that and died for you, you are holy, blameless, and without a single fault. That's insane, insane kindness, right? But listen, that's not an excuse to remain the same person because God forgives. Because, here's a great one. God knows my heart. Yeah, it's black and wicked. He knows that too. Oh, that's just the way God made me. I got news for you guys, okay? That's not the way God made you. See, the Bible, which is the word of God, it says that he made you for him. He created you to worship him and to be like him. Like, that's what he made you for. He didn't make you this way so you could say, oh, well, this is just the way God made me. He knows my heart. No. No, you don't know your heart. Your heart deceives you. You think this is the way God made you. No, that's what you chose to do. You sinner. Me too. So you made me this way, Lord, and we're cool. It's all good, right? It's all good. Or is it? I mean, I understand that when he went to the cross, he forgives me for my sin, but we have to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. Like, there's something that's got to happen in our life right now. Glory is not just some far off, you know, some dream thing when everyone's on clouds playing harps and stuff like that. It's something going on here. He said, I came that you might have life to the full. Right now, right here, right now. So we have to work out something. Something has to be done here. We can't just stay just stuck in a rut being the same guy that we were before he did this for us. Here's the thing. The Bible says that we're holy, blameless, and without single fault. So let's have an honest to goodness discussion in church. Don't lie. Who in this room is blameless? How many people in this room are without a single fault? And you just got one. No, so now how many people in here are like, not whole, like there's different facets of what holy is, like different facets of that diamond, you know. Holy is like set apart, you're God's kid now, so if you said yes, yeah, you're holy, that's cool. But I mean like, holy, like God holy, like perfect. How many people in here are that? That baby can't raise its hand either. Sorry to break the bad news to you. Nobody can, right? So here's the deal. We know that we're not holy. We know that we're not without single fault. And we know that we're not blameless. Like that's the reality, right? We know this. But yet, there's another reality. There's another reality right now, as real as this desk right here, is that we, if you have accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are holy and blameless and without single fault. That there's two realities right there, right? So let me ask you a question. When those two realities collide in your head, and you're thinking about that, and I want to literally give you a moment to think about this. When the two realities that God says that I'm holy and blameless and without single fault, like that's the truth of Almighty God who created everything, so it's got to be true, but yet I look over here and I cuss when I stub my toe, and I'm greedy and I'm selfish and I yelled at my wife and all these different things, right? I was talking about you, not me. What happens when those two realities collide in your head? What begins to swell up in your heart? Think about it. You're not blameless. You're not without fault, but yet the Creator of heaven and earth says that you are. There should be some smiles up in here. You know what I'm saying? There should be some smiling. Woo! Right? Yeah. Yeah, right? What starts swelling up in your heart? Can I give you a Bible verse? Because whatever's swelling up in your heart right now, I want to make sure that it gets lined up with the Word of God, what should be happening inside of you. If you go back to Colossians 2:7, it says, let your roots grow down into Jesus Christ. Let your life be built upon Christ. And then your faith will grow strong by the truth that you've been taught. And what happens then? It says, and you will overflow with thankfulness. Yeah. You will overflow with thankfulness. I am not blameless. I am not without fault. I am not holy, but the one who went to the cross says that I am. I'm thankful for that, right? Yeah, come on. I'm thankful for that. Psalm 23, David says, he says, my cup overflows. My cup overflows, Psalm 28:7. Listen to this one. It says, he helps me, and my heart is filled with joy, and I burst in songs of thanksgiving. I mean, just think of that picture. I had a great illustration. I was going to come out here with a super soaker and drench you guys in that office before the service started. I couldn't get in the basement quick enough. I was going to hammer you all. And the pressure builds inside your heart when you're just reflecting on all that he's done, how much he's helped me and how much he's loved me. And it just starts filling in your heart swells with joy and the overflow, wham! And I was going to get you. I was going to get you. I was going to get you. You. Psalm 100, verse 4, enter his gates with thanksgiving. See, that's the goal here. It's not religious activities, not up, down, all around, and sing Hail Marys. It's not about that. It's not about communion. It's not about baptism. It's not about how much we pray, what songs we sing, or what we look like, what we dress, how we conduct ourselves in our service. It's thanksgiving in the heart that overflows. That's what he wants, and that gets expressed a thousand different ways. It's not in routine. It's not a routine. So why do we meditate on God's word that reflects? This whole book is filled with all these insane things that God did for people. Why do we read this book that brings us back to all these remarkable, powerful deeds where he provided and he saved and he loved on his people? Why do we do that? To make good movies? Maybe. Why do we get alone in our time of prayer and start reflecting back on the times that he blessed me and helped me and came through for me, and when I called out to my Father in heaven and he delivered for me? Why do I do those things? Psalm 28:7, like I just said, he helps me. And you reflect back on what he's done for me, and what happens when you do that? My heart is just bursting with joy, and out of it sings songs of thanksgiving. That's what he's looking for from his people. That's what he's looking for. It's like I got so much God, like I got to get rid of some of this stuff. You know what I mean? I got so much God in my pockets. Here, take some of my God. I can't take any more God. I was watching that movie, Do You Believe? A lot of us watch that now. It's an awesome flick, right? Awesome flick. And I was kind of feeling like that when I was watching the movie. I was, you know, some of these movies are real cheesy, these cheesy Christian movies, you know? But they're all the same. We got one guy, one girl, life's completely jacked up like crazy, and somehow they find Jesus and everything's, peaches and cream, you know. That's what happens in all these movies. And it's usually either one girl, one guy, or, you know, one kid, or one family. They're good, you know. But this movie was crazy. This movie had like seven different people, and they're all doing their own thing, but somehow they all Jesus, and it's just everyone's getting saved, and they're loving God and loving each other. And it was like, I'm sitting there in my living room, I'm watching this, and I'm like, you know, crying like crazy. And I was just like this close to just going, Meredith, just turn this thing off. I can't take it anymore. Like all this redemption at once. I couldn't stand it anymore. I was like, I can't even watch this. It was overwhelming. And that's what I was thinking of. My heart's just filled with joy, and I got to get rid of some of this God. You know what I'm saying? If you ever see me going down the street, go like this, just run. Just run. I have a problem. You all think I'm insane, don't you? I love you all. I do love you all. I couldn't do this anywhere else except here, you know. You guys realize that, right? Yeah. So by God's grace, because he's so nice, he's just nice. He's nice. He's nice, 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 nice. I know it's not a churchy word, but I don't care what churches think. He's nice. He just gives you this incredible gift that you don't deserve. So by his grace, you are holy, blameless, and without single fault. But because of his grace, I'm thankful. I'm thankful. Truly knowing God will never drive you to religious. It's not the right thing to say. It's not the right thing to say. I actually do have a filter. I do. But we're driven to thankfulness, and we reflect on who he is and what he's done and who I am and who I was and what I did and my pile and then who I am now. And it's like, that shouldn't drive me to make sure I take, you know, sing the right hymns in the right order and dress a certain way. And like, you know what it should drive me to do? Woo! You know, I'm just giddy. Woo, Jesus. You know what I'm saying? Thankful. That's what it should drive you to do. Be thankful. Be thankful. Colossians 3:15 says, always be thankful. Goes on in the book of Colossians, the next verse, it says, and then now we're talking about coming to church now, right? Listen to this. It says, sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Pause. Look at me. Don't read on. Why? Why do we sing this song? Why are we singing this stuff? Well, I'll sing that song because I like that song. Well, I'll sing that song because I like the words of that song and I like the way she sings that song. And that one's loud, this one's quiet. I like that song. But the songs that I don't like, I'm just going to sit here like, bah, humbug. I don't like that song. Church down the road has better music than they do. When they start singing the songs I like, I'll go back. You know why we sing the songs? I'm ripping on everybody. You know what? Because I've done the same thing. This song's I don't like. This song's you guys sing, I do not like. If they sing Days of Elijah, you will see me sit there and I will not stand up. Oh. There's no God like Jehovah. Like, what is that? What's the other one? Yeah, like the people are going to come in that don't know Jesus. These are the days of Ezekiel. Who the heck is Ezekiel? The dry bones are becoming flesh. What is that? It's awesome. Good. Sing it. I'll take that week off. It's awesome. Just kidding. Why do we sing? Why do we sing the songs? With a thankful heart. Who gives a rip what the song is? You love Jesus. You just sing to him, right? That's why we come and we sing with a thankful heart. It's to express all the wonderful things that he's done, who he is, what he's done in your life, what he's done in your family, what he's done in your church. You just love him, so you sing with a thankful heart. That's what it is. You just sing with a thankful heart. That's why you're singing, is to just be, to express the thanksgiving that's overflowing from your heart because of all that he's done for you. He goes on to say here in that same verse, if you're not singing, you might be doing some other things. Maybe you're praying. Maybe you're giving. Maybe you're just sitting here listening. Maybe you're reading the Bible. I don't know what you're doing. But it says, and whatever you do or say, do it as a representative of the Lord Jesus. Why? Giving thanks to God the Father through him. There's a song. You guys know that song? Giving thanks to God the Father through him. You never saw that VBS disc? I'm the only loser in the house. Okay, cool. Thankfulness is the goal. Thankfulness is the goal. The cross was not aimed at your hands to make you do certain things. It was aimed at your heart. And if it transforms your heart, your hands will automatically do what's going on in here. That's what will happen. I don't have to pray. See, a lot of us feel like we have to pray. See, that's religion. I have to pray. No, you don't have to pray. I get to pray because I get to tell him how thankful I am. Yeah. I don't have to go to, do you ever feel that way? I have, hey, you guys want to go fishing? You guys want to go to the game? You want to go to this? No, I have to go to church. Really? Why don't you just tell the person that church sucks and they should never go? Oh, I have to go to church. That's like, I have to get a root canal. How about I get to go to church because I get to tell him how awesome he is and tell everybody else about the goodness of God. That's why we go to church, right? I talked about giving a little bit ago where you feel like you have to tithe, you know, like, I got to give. Tithe means 10, you know. I got to give 10% because if I don't, God's going to hate me. That's so lame. Some people in here are tithers. I'm not. I'm a microphone guy, so I can talk louder than you right now. I'm not a tither. You know what I am? I'm a Bible giver. I want to decide in my own heart, like I read to you, what I should give. And so I don't have to tithe. I get to give because I realize where all my blessings come from. That's why. That's the new attitude. I'm not obligated to help anybody. I get to serve because why? Because Jesus served me. Crazy, right? Crazy. He served me, so I get to serve. It's a change of attitude. It's what's going on inside the heart. You know, God, you ripped me from the sticky hands of an eternal hell, and you placed me in Christ beyond the reach of the enemy at the right hand of the Father. I'm thankful for this. And out of that thanksgiving comes the overflow, and that's what's displayed in my life. That's what God's looking for in the believer. The Bible says that we are the bride of Christ. All you dudes, you're a chick now. Ha! That's it. We're the bride of Christ. The bride of Christ, right? I don't know what he's talking about. He's just doing this like usual. Did you ever see Lady and the Tramp? Remember the muzzle? So, anyone wants to buy one, it's fine. So, who's married? Anyone married in here? Right? Who's got a boyfriend or a girlfriend? Dude, that dude's married? Wow, stud. Yeah, you got boyfriend or girlfriend, anyone in here? Right, yeah, that's cool. Anyone ever want to have a spouse? Be kind of cool, right? So you can say yes, because Beth's not in here. It's cool. You went, I own you, sit in the front seat, this is what happens. Okay, so here's the thing, right? How would you like it if every time your husband or wife, your spouse, or your boyfriend or girlfriend, they did something for you and it was just completely out of obligation? What husband, I know you'd like to eat, so most men like to go from hungry to full, don't care what they're eating, but how many people would like it if they came home and their wife cooked them dinner because she felt she had to? Like, would that? What if she kissed you, or he kissed you because he felt he had to? I mean, that would suck, right? I mean, basically, right? Wouldn't it? That would be awful. If it was just pure obligation, that you serve the other because of pure obligation, because you have to. Like, it's the, I have to go to church, I have to give, I have to pray, I have to cook him dinner, I have to make him happy, I have to go home and entertain my wife, I have to do this, I have to take care of my kids. Not, I get to, I have to. Like, how many people would think that their marriage would be a huge success if that was the basis of all service there? What about, man, she is funny and she is beautiful and she loves the Lord and she cooks for me and she cleans for me and she deals with me and she prays for me and she shares her feelings with me and she shares her days with me and she shares her bed with me. Like, she could have chose one of millions of other, but she chose me. How about reflecting on that, and out of that, serving her becomes an overflow of a heart filled with thanksgiving. Amen? That's the same thing with Jesus. It's the same exact thing. See, when we There's another church term, you know, we talk about repentance. When you repent of your, you know, we keep doing stuff and it's sorry, 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 sorry. Like, you can do that. God knows my heart. Yeah, I know. Obviously you don't. But you could keep doing that, but that's not repentance. Repentance is not just, I'm sorry, God. Like, that's cool. He lets you do that. But see, repentance is not just, I'm sorry. It's turning from your normal, usual patterns of sin and changing and turning towards Jesus and saying, Jesus, I'm sorry that I did this, and I'm not going to do it again. That's repentance. And when you think back and you meditate on all that God has done for you, right? What happens? I'm not holy. I'm not blameless. I'm not without fault. Yet the King of the universe, who absolutely should turn his cheek from me and let me go down and burn, doesn't. He sends Jesus to the cross to pay, to absorb the full wrath of all mankind into his Son so that you could live forever. So that you could be holy. So you could be Jesus. You guys tracking what I'm saying? You're not Jesus, but you could be Jesus. You could be holy. You could be blameless. You could be without fault. The only person who ever was Jesus, and you get to be just like him. You don't deserve any of it. And when you start thinking about that, it should drive you to be thankful. And out of this thankful heart, the overflow of thanksgiving, you don't just say, I'm sorry anymore. I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. No, you stop doing it. You change. You stop apologizing to God, and you start being transformed by God to be like God. That's what he created you to be. Let us make man in our image to be like us. Genesis 1:26, Romans 8:29, New Testament says God's desire is that all of us would be conformed into the image of Christ, his Son. Jesus doesn't just keep going, oh, I'm sorry, Dad, I'm sorry, Dad, I'm sorry, Dad. No, he didn't do that. He didn't do the bad things. So he wants to be like Jesus, right? Quit doing it. Don't make excuses. If anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old has died, and behold, the new man. I'm going to close with this one verse, 2 Corinthians 4:15. And it's just this meditating on what God has done, who he is, who you are versus who he is, comparing the two, bringing them together, the reality collides in your mind. It's like, whoa, my Lord, I can't believe he saved me. 2 Corinthians 4:15 just says, as the grace of God reaches more and more people, there will be great thanksgiving. And God will receive more and more glory. More and more grace to more and more people results in more and more glory for God. But how is that expressed? Is it expressed by opening up another church that acts a certain way to represent God a certain way? What should be going on in the church when they come in here? Should it be stale and irrelevant and so somber and so reverent? Like, this is God, the creator of heaven and earth, we're talking to here and we're talking about. So absolute reverence, like he's the king. But when they come into the church, the gathering of the saints, right? Thanksgiving should be, like, we should be running around with little stickers in our pockets, say, God, handing it out to everybody, like, I got so much God, you got to get some of this God, woo! It should look like the side of a mountain in Vermont in October. Like, wow, look at God's doing, like, you look at it, you're like, wow, right? People should walk in here and go, wow, these people are thrilled. I can't believe what's going on in their life. They love God so much, they have to tell you all about it. Woo! I can't believe what God did. That's the goal. So God's work in us, his redemptive work in us on a continuing basis, that working out of your salvation with fear and trembling in your life right now, the goal, what God's trying to do inside of you is not produce religious activities that really have no substance behind them. He's trying to work inside you a thankful heart that's overflowing with thanksgiving and joy and singing of songs. happy, celebrating, laughing, smiling. That's what the smile should be ear to ear from every Christian. No matter what happens, no matter what happens, you should be joyful. You should be happy. I'm not ripping on you because you might have had a bad day. But when you think about the present problem you're having right now compared to future glory forever, right? I don't know about you, but I can't stop smiling right now. That's crazy. I'm gonna go home, and I love my wife, but you know she's gonna make me mad, and I'm gonna make her mad, and the kids are gonna drive me crazy, and I'm struggling financially. All these different things. I get it. But man, all these present troubles pale in comparison when I think about the cross. You know, when I think about the cross that is rotten and wretched as I was, and this pile of dung that I brought to Jesus, and I climbed up on a ladder and I put it in that basket. But he looks at me as holy, blameless, and without fault. And that's the way he looks at you. Can you imagine if you were a son or a daughter of a parent, that no matter what you did, your dad would look at you and go, "My son can do no wrong." That's the way God looks at you. Doesn't matter what you do. See, there's the blood of Christ over you. And underneath here, it's all funky and yunky. You were doing stuff every day. Yeah, gross. But your daddy looks at you and says, "You can do no wrong." He's just crazy about you. He adores you. And when you think about that, what should start swelling up in your mind? What should start swelling up in your heart? It should be an overflow of thanksgiving, right? And a smile like he's got right there. That's awesome, right? Smiles start popping on people's faces. There's another one right there. There's another one of Robert right there. Paula's got one. Lydia's got one. You can't hold his in. It's crazy, right? Let's pray and we'll thank him. Right, and then listen, when we pray, don't you dare leave this room. We're going to sing. We're going to sing songs and hymns and spiritual songs with a thankful heart.